$5,000 and potentially a year in jail. New penalties for paparazzi who put lives in danger for a photo. Look at this video of supermodel Kate Moss being swarmed by cameras at LAX, the airport. It was a key exhibit in the case against relentless tabloids. And now California's lawmakers have voted 43-13 in favor of new fallout, pretty severe too, as I said, for shutterbugs who jeopardize celebrity safety. Joining me now to discuss it, our power panel, Diane Davis, director of Shelter Pop and Lifestyles Editor for the Associated Press, Deneen Borelli, senior fellow for Project 21 and a Fox News contributor, and Dr. Cynara Coomer, who is on our Fox News Medical A-Team. So I'll tell you this. Let me start with you, Diane, because you're a member of the press. The downside of this law is sometimes journalists go a little fast in getting from point A to point B. They, too, now, thanks to this law, might have to pay $5,000 and potentially go to jail for a year because they won't, they too would be considered in violation of the law.
That's right. I was talking with a friend of mine who used to be an editor at one of the celebrity tabs, and she said, you know what, those guys are thugs, and I think they need laws like this. But on the other hand, when you start mucking around with the First Amendment and the freedom of the press, you don't know what's going to happen. So as the California Newspaper Publishers Association pointed out, you could be a legitimate journalist on your way to accident, crime scene, etc., and you could be fined under this law for endangerment.
I mean, Deneen, you look at this and you think, this is, look at her with her daughter, you know, trying to get away from this madness, and you feel nothing but empathy for her. Thanks to Hollywood TV, by the way, for the video. But these can be a slippery slope, these laws.
It can be a slippery slope, and I am concerned about an individual's safety, absolutely. But there is a point where you have these Hollywood elites who could be getting special treatment. And I don't recall seeing a bunch of security guards around her. So it's her responsibility, or anyone who's in the spotlight, because with fame, you're going to have these people who are going to be chasing you.
And clearly, about people, that might work for somebody like her, but what about somebody like Octomom, who gets fame thrust upon them, and, you know, Octomom couldn't go out there and hire a bunch of security guards. Maybe Kate Moss could, but, you know, others need protection.
It's true. I mean, I agree with the point that this certainly can be a slippery slope. But, you know, at the same time, they have a right to be able to protect themselves and to protect the people around them, like their children and their families,
that's
who didn't sign
really
up for the celebrity part of this.
It's right. The child.
Right, exactly. And then they shouldn't necessarily be obligated all the time to have security around them 24/7. I mean, there has to be a fine line between being able to live your life and being a celebrity and the public persona as well.
It's not like she's harping down to Waverly Inn here in New York, and where you know paparazzi. She's just arriving at the airport. They need to fly. They can't all get private jets and go into private airports. All right. But speaking of somebody who can definitely afford his own private jet and his own private airport and anything else he wants to buy, George Clooney, who now is speaking out about the greatest failure of his life. And what is it? Is it the, you know, failure not to get a certain role, an Oscar? No, not to solve the genocide that is going on in Darfur. I mean, listen, is it just me, Deneen, or is a little hubris playing out here? Good for him for trying to help,
but it's
the greatest failure of his personal life.
Well, that's between him and, you know, his consultants. But, you know, I applaud his efforts if he is sincere about this, trying to make a difference.
Right, which I believe he
is. Yeah. The flip side, what this tells us is that how incompetent and inefficient the UN is. I mean, what are they doing all the time?
Relying
the money,
on George.
Research, yeah. So what is it that they're doing? It's Darfur, there's Rwanda, the list goes on and on, oil for food. So for many, many years, we are faced with these issues and nothing is changing.
I mean, I do like him for his efforts. A lot of these celebrities do nothing, right, Diane? But it's the greatest failure of his life not to solve the genocide?
It is perhaps a little over the top and perhaps an example of his fine acting.
You think?
Right, correct. But, you know, I say any celebrity who's willing to take responsibility for their fame and their fortune and say, I'm trying to do something with it, I give them credit.
Yeah.
Not everybody does that.
But they think that they're larger in large than life. I mean, you know, and I give him credit for coming out and saying, listen, this was my greatest failure, and this was it was well-intentioned, and it's an honest assessment that he couldn't do anything about it. But really, did he think he could in the first place? I mean, we're talking about a country. We're talking about a government that the corruption
is
so deep.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I just feel like what happens to these Hollywood celebrities like this who get so huge, and, you know, you got to give credit. Rosie O'Donnell, of all people, wrote about this in her crazy book about how fame and celebrity drives them crazy about how she started to believe the red light signals no longer applied to her. And I'm just thinking that, like, now it actually goes to the point of, and I can solve the genocides in the country, in the world. All right, I got to move on to Sarah Palin. Sure. Yet another hit piece by Vanity Fair against her. It goes on for 24 pages. Right. And the guy comes out and says, I didn't want to do it. I actually, you know, I was a Palin fan, but the more I talked to people, the more I learned that she has a pattern of lying, that her on-the-record statements amount to a litany of untruths and half-truths. It goes on to say, and I quote, anywhere you peel back the skin of Sarah Palin's life, a sad and moldering strangeness lies beneath. Goes on to talk about how she's a bad tipper, she's indifferent and angry in private, and on it goes. And now some, Doc, are saying this is actually a sexist piece, right, because some of the criticisms he has of her as a politician, lashing out and so on, never would have been made of a male politician.
I think the only thing he didn't do was go and ask Levi what his opinion of Sarah Palin is.
Oh, I think he did. I think he's one of the unnamed sources.
One of the unnamed sources, probably. Right. You know what? This again, the source, Vanity Fair, you know you're not going to get a pro Sarah Palin speech. I happen to like Sarah Palin a lot. I just think she does probably need to reinvent
you
herself
a little
bit. You
must be a dum-dum.
Yeah, I know. I am. And a bigot and everything else that goes
along with
it. That's
his conclusion. You must be stupid or fooled by the
right.
lies.
Well, what can I say? I guess I fall into that group. But I think she's going to have to reinvent herself a little bit if she's going to appeal to the masses, especially if she's looking at a presidential run.
I think that's well accepted, right, if she wants to appeal to the masses. But Diane, as you read this piece, does it smack at all of independence and sort of neutral reporting to you? To me, it just seems like the guy hates her.
Well, I will say, and I am probably not a huge Sarah Palin fan, so I don't know if that makes me smart according to this article.
Right, you're smart.
Smarter than me.
Smarty pants.
I think what I found most interesting about it was it really dissected what goes into making the image of a politician like Sarah Palin, looking at her consultants and her stylists and her aides. And you know what? That is no different than any other politician. But I think we as Americans tend to forget what goes into the making of that image. So I just found that rather eye-opening. Yeah, I don't think he had any love for her, though.
It's so obvious the left hates her. You're right. They can't stand her. And with everything that's going on in our country, the economy, unemployment, for them to keep pushing this, this complaints about her, and she's not even running for office.
But the amount of investigation he did into her life, Deneen, not to mention this guy who's now taken up residence against or next to her for the summer.
Right.
What's his name? For the
They're intimidated by her.
Yeah, Joe McGinnis. Thank you. Yeah. But why the obsession? She's not running for anything now. She does have a lot of power, but you could argue that it's weakening. So, but still, the obsession is not.
Well, they're trying to discredit her, just in case she does run. So they're starting now to try to, block all these efforts and trying to make people think that she is this really mean and crazy and evil person.
I just found it
amazing. We don't even know if this
they
is
followed
true.
Her around. They followed around the bellhops and said, how much did she tip you? They went up to the maids in the hotel rooms and said, how much did she tip you? They want to know exactly. They tell you how much she spent on underwear during the campaign, on Spanx. By the way, no amount is too much.
So true.
All
and
right,
by
ladies.
The way, they make pregnant ones too.
They do. I remember I was pregnant. And it's like you gotta pull it up, and then you get to your belly, and it's like, ooh, comes right over. Okay. Thank you so much, panel.
Thanks.